Welcome to Vicinities Europe, the first pan-European current affairs talk show, presented today by Tim Judah and Susan Nadeau.
Hello and welcome to our show. We've gathered guests from different countries and backgrounds to talk about the issues that are important to the people of Europe. Today, we will look at some current events and what they mean for Europe.
We're calling this edition of the show Quo Vadis Europe, as we'll be asking our guests their opinions about the future of the European idea and its values.
First, we'd like to welcome our guests, Professor Florian Bieber.
I think this is a decisive year for the European Union, a make or break year. Either it will manage to grow together and become stronger, or it will wither away amidst all the crises it's facing.
Sylvie Lauda.
Europe faces major challenges at the moment, so it's crucial we talk about the facts rather than unfounded legends and myths.
Mr. Stefane Grueso.
And I came here to show you that in Spain there are people that care about themselves, about the neighborhood, about the city, but also about Europe. And we want to build a real democracy. So please join us and let's do this now.
And Nenad Shebek.
I always saw the European Union, and by extension Europe, as a system of values first and foremost. And what worries me is that I see the system of values under serious threat right now.
I would like to also welcome our audience. We have members of the European Alternatives Network. We have some alumni from the European Fund for the Balkans programs. We have students from a joint program with the University of Belgrade and the University of Graz.
Let's start with a question for our students and program alumni. Has the EU reached its limit under the current model as to how it can act as one entity? Yes or no? Just to remind our viewers, the European Union was founded in the wake of the Second World War and has grown to some 28 member states now, with many more waiting in the wings. It is, of course, a political union, but for the 19 members of the Eurozone, it's also a monetary union.
This summer, the Greek economic crisis threatened to unravel the Eurozone, shaking the foundations of the European Union itself. The situation was so tense that the Greek government placed capital controls on banks, allowing people to take out just 60 euros a day from their accounts. Banks were closed, and some ATMs ran out of cash. Supplies of insulin and cancer drugs, which are sold to Greece from other countries, dwindled in pharmacies and hospitals. In the end, Greece's government, led by the leftist party Syriza, agreed to new austerity measures to avoid further collapse, even after the citizens voted against them. In exchange, Greece was to receive some 80 billion euros in bailout loans. Now, European Commission President Jean-Claude Juncker, one of the architects of the 16-year-old euro, has called for a eurozone treasury.
The question we'd like to ask is, if one member state of the Eurozone is somehow allowed to or forced to leave, is the system itself flawed? Let's start with you, Florian Bieber.
Well, I think one of the fundamental principles of the European Union is that countries can leave. So I think if it's a free choice, then it is nothing wrong with a country leaving it. Of course, in the case of Greece, it's more an issue of being forced out, or that was the sentiment. But I think the very fact that it cut a corner in many ways in recent months, that despite a referendum, despite the crisis, in fact, Greece has remained in the Eurozone, and there's been considerable effort made by EU member states, would suggest to me that there is the possibility to leave, but when push comes to shove, in the end, a country would not like to leave, and the others would go out of their way to try to prevent it from happening. So in that sense, it is rather a sign of cohesion than of disintegration.
Stefanie?
Well, in this case of Greece, I find that it wasn't some kind of normal decision. It was just a blackmail. I mean, the Greek people are suffering. The government tried to do something about it. But then some forces into Europe, I don't know if it was France, Germany, or some companies maybe, just wanted to throw them out or to blackmail them. So I think we have to take care of these things. We cannot allow this to happen again.
On this side?
Well, I feel like if it would be actually a realistic option, Greece leaving, it would have happened years ago. Just a slight reminder, me as a journalist, I feel like I read about Greece being in a very, very serious situation for at least 5 years. We all remember the summits, which go all night, and all the reports in Financial Times and elsewhere saying Europe has reached, or European Union in this case, has reached its limits. It's very serious. We can't go on like this. Yet it does go on further. So I feel like if it would be actually on the table, it would have happened years ago. So I don't think that's actually a realistic option. I feel more serious question is Brexit. So the United Kingdom actually leaving the European Union. And I think it would have more dire consequences for the Union than actually Greece leaving.
I see the Greek crisis primarily as a political crisis and then as an economic and a financial crisis. I think that what we are seeing in the economic and the financial field are the consequences. And I think that the roots lie in political decisions. Would the European Union survive a Greek exit or a UK exit? Yes, I think it would. If the European Union could have survived such a series of enlargements and has sort of come from 12 to 15 to 27, 28 now, surely it can survive one country leaving. However, I believe that it will be a completely, thoroughly, utterly wrong kind of a message for the other member states. So I'm hoping that we will not get to the stage where there will be either a Grexit or a Brexit.
Mm-hmm. We'll get back to enlargement. But Tim, why don't we talk about Brexit?
As it stands now, the British government is, of course, beginning to negotiate with the European Union, with the member states of the European Union, the idea being that there should be a referendum in 2017 or before that. But do you think that there is a will when it comes to not only the future of Britain in Europe, but the future of Europe as a whole, to make the Union a more secure place for its members? I'm not talking about physical security, of course, I'm talking about the security of the Union, of a functioning Union. Or is there basically a fundamental lack of solidarity when a push comes to shove? Sylvie, let's start with you first, because you mentioned Brexit.
Well, I noticed very interesting sort of political movements in some European countries recently. Deputy Prime Minister of Germany, also some ministers of French government, publicly expressed support for the multi-speed Europe, which we all know already exists, but they stressed the need for Europe to go on different speeds. And I don't think that's a coincidence that they did say this just before David Cameron visited Berlin in Sigmar Gabriel's case. So I think there is a clear will on the side of the major players in the European Union to keep Britain inside of the Union. How it's going to look, however, I don't think that we understand much yet what is Britain actually demanding. There are some very general goals David Cameron is demanding, but I don't think anybody can imagine now what it actually means. So we will have to wait for that. But I think there is will definitely to reform in order to keep this major state in the Union.
Okay, does anyone else want to pick up on that?
Yeah. I mean, I think what is, in my view, I think a clear issue there is that Britain is so central, I think, to the European Union as a country, and that, although, you know, joined only in 73, but like it is, I think, a core pillar. And I think, so from that point of view, I think that the incentive is very strong to keep it in. What is interesting is in the past, all the other members have excluded treaty changes. But I think with the crisis we see this year, the crisis over Greece, as well as the refugee crisis, I think the need, maybe not for a treaty change, but to kind of reconceptualize the European Union is going to become more pertinent. And I think this is exactly maybe a moment, an opportunity to have this debate, maybe not now when we're in a crisis mode, but maybe in the next year, to actually think about, rethink the European Union. And I think this, I mean, in that sense, the Brexit threat or the referendum might be a blessing in disguise in the sense that it forces this debate, which others might be reluctant to lead otherwise.
Mm-hmm. Stéphane Grueso, I see you nodding.
Yes, I mean, you said something about what kind of Europe do we want? And we have to think in these ways. I mean, what kind of Europe do we have? You said something about solidarity. I want to tell you that because of this refugee crisis, the Prime Minister of my country, he said that we can show some solidarity, but there are two kinds of solidarity, the normal solidarity and the solidarity when you get something in return. So what kind of Europe do we want? I mean, we need to help these peoples. Europe needs to help these peoples. You know, Europe needs to be a democracy. And I mean, there are no red lines with human rights and these things. So, I mean, yes, we have now this problem with the Greek, possible Greek exit, the Brit, and so on. But I think we have to look further in and see what kind of Europe do we want.
When it comes to my adopted country, the United Kingdom, I could never actually understand the extremely strong anti-EU sentiments which always seem to be present among the public at large, especially amongst the in the media, and I can't really predict what's going to happen at a referendum as and when it comes. But looking at sort of the European Union and its future, we already have a multi-tier Europe. We have the European Union as it is of the 28, we have the monetary EU, which is the Eurozone, and we have the Schengen zone, which again, so we already have a three-tier European Union which exists. I have always believed in an asymmetrical union. I think there's nothing wrong with having an outer confederalist core, confederalist circle, and an internal federalist core. And I think that is a very likely and a very possible and a very doable future for the Europe. I mean, the conflict of interest between nation states and a supranational organization like the EU always was, always is, and always will be. But I think this is a good way of sort of overcoming that particular that particular phenomenon.
And perhaps before I hand back to you, but perhaps also provides means for absorbing in one way or another bigger countries like Turkey and Ukraine in the future. But yes. I'm just throwing that out there.
But there are so many, there are some arguments against this, which I think are also interesting. I think what's really the crisis, I mean now economical crisis and the refugee crisis uncovered, which I think it's a very interesting opinion, is that the integration which was done was not done in a serious enough way. I really like this quote from Guy Verhofstadt, which is the leader of the liberals in European Union, and he said Europe is extremely good in putting out policies, but not so good in putting out rules and institutions to fulfill those policies. So in the economical crisis, what we saw was, yes, there was a common currency, but the decision about debts and budgets were still left on the national governments. In the migration crisis, yes, we have common borders, but the asylum systems are dramatically different in each and every country. So the argument against the multi-speed Europe is it will even deepen this sort of uneven, let's say, rules, which could even complicate things.
Right. And we'll look at that. Yeah, we'll get further into that now. But before we do that, let's look at what our students and alumni answered to that first question. Question was, has the EU reached its limit under the current model as to how it can act as one? We have yes, 60%, and no, 40%.
Well, I'd like to call on Pierre Zombetsky, one of our students on the panel here, to tell us why you answered the way that you did, and how did you answer? Pierre, you're from Germany. Over to you.
I have to say I also answered yes, because I would say that under the current form, all the limits were reached, as we can see from current crises, maybe financial or border crises, as I call it on purpose. But I would also say that there's space for transformation, and that the people, at least of Europe, are ready for it, and we have to see if politics are as well.
Our next question for the audience is, did the talk, just the talk of the possibility of Greece exiting the Eurozone, weaken the union? More recently, this has come up already, of course, Europe has been facing a humanitarian crisis, the largest movement of refugees on the continent since World War II. We have some photos we'd like to share, a short video, so we'll play those now, and then we'll discuss it.
In 2015, an estimated 1 million migrants and refugees will enter Europe, hoping to find safety, opportunity, and much more. So far, half of them have made the dangerous journey across the Mediterranean from North Africa, and others have crossed short but dangerous stretches of sea from Turkey. The numbers, however, are overwhelming some governments. Now, some border controls have been reimposed, putting at risk the Schengen Treaty that has allowed for free movement around much of Europe for some 20 years.
Well, certainly we've been reading and seeing heart-wrenching stories over the last few weeks and months from migrants and refugees. On the political side, of course, there are quite deep concerns about taking in large numbers of people from different cultures so quickly. I'd like to throw this out. Why has Europe had such a difficult time acting as a single entity, coming up with policies and plans to deal with these refugees and migrants?
it's not just a question of difficulty reaching decisions when it comes to the migrants. It's a question of reaching decisions in the first place. The European Union has not got an efficient system of decision making. It still is using the old system from the EU of 12 member states, which was basically when France and Germany would agree upon something, then they would persuade the UK to go along, and then basically everybody would do what was agreed. Today there are 28 member states in it. We still use essentially the same system of decision-making, and it simply doesn't work. The decision-making process is something that probably should have been sorted out before the Big Bang in 2004, before the EU expanded to 27 and then 28, but it wasn't done. So we have an inefficient system to cope with anything that comes our way, whether it's the refugee crisis or the Greek financial crisis or anything else.
Well, and this crisis is particularly heart-wrenching. And so you mentioned something earlier, Stefane Grueso, I'd like your comment on this as well.
Yes, I mean, in Spain, we have some issue with the migrant crisis, with refugees. We have these south borders where thousands of people, they'll try to enter. Now we have this situation where our government is going to fly in a couple of thousands of refugees from Central Europe, but we have these Syrians and these people from Iraq in our own borders. So, I mean, I see this crisis, this refugee crisis, as an opportunity to advance a little bit in this Europe we want. I mean, we have to join, and then this thing of these 120,000 people that we're going to house in Europe, what happens with the next one? I mean, the 100,001 refugee, is he going to die? So, I mean, we have to apply to our governments to do something, to join, to do... You know, it's very frustrating for the citizens to see that the EU will call an urgent reunion about this issue, and it will take place in like 3 weeks. So, I mean, they have to act. I agree with the colleague on these decision policies, and, well, I will see this as an opportunity.
Florian, I'd like to come to you about this. I mean, Nanad's right, isn't it? You've got 28 people in a room. It's hard to make a decision, especially if people have different interests. How are we going to overcome this in the future, if we're going to overcome it?
But I think it's not just a matter of 28 people in the room. I mean, we've had a majority decision within the European Union now on the refugee redistribution. But even that is very weak. I mean, we see, I think it's such a sensitive issue for so many countries. So that's the first problem. It hits so many buttons and people worry about the rise of extreme nationalist or populist parties in Europe. And I think that's the second one. And it hits also the idea of conventional sovereignty, the idea that you can protect the borders. And I think what we saw is, in fact, Europe borders cannot be protected. You need a policy to actually deal with both refugees and migration. And the fact is that, you know, the Schengen system fell apart. The Dublin idea, the idea that refugees have the first safe haven in the European Union where they enter, has fallen apart. Greece is no longer able to play this role. And I think this just shows not just the decision-making weakness, but the weakness of the system as such. And I think what we need to do is rethink this. And also, I think what is forgotten in the debate, it's not a matter of freedom of choice. I mean, refugees who are fleeing are, you know, we are obliged in Europe by conventions to actually protect them. And it's and for me, it's actually quite heartbreaking to see that, you know, people are selling life vests in Izmir now so that people don't drown on the way to Europe. And instead of being able to, you know, fly to safety, to be processed as refugees in Turkey or wherever they are refugees. So I think this is really, I mean, it's a tragic moment for Europe, not just in terms of decision making, but also in terms of how we deal with human beings fleeing from war.
And you bring up an interesting point too, the Schengen Agreement. Psychologically, what does this do? What we've seen, this you know, temporary revoking of the agreement of the free movement around Europe, what does this do to Europe? What does this mean?
Well, I come from the Czech Republic, and we saw in the Czech media a headline saying the end of Schengen. And that's another example how general European topics are not communicated in the correct way. And it's not only in the Czech Republic, it's all over Europe. And I think that's a huge problem about Europe at the moment, that not many people, including myself, by the way, clearly understand how Europe functions, who decides what, who can decide what, and what are the limits of the decision making. And I think that's one of the problems. But what I want to say is this, it's not the end of Schengen. When you look at the rules of Schengen, temporary border controls are still a right of every member state of the Schengen area. So it's not the end of Schengen. No. But of course, the symbolism of it, it's very strong. And just very briefly, to say one thing about the refugee crisis, just to put it into perspective, there are 50 million people misplaced in the world at the moment. It's the highest number since Second World War. And roughly 1 million expected to come to, over 1 million to come to Europe. So I feel almost ashamed that the richest continent, or one of the richest continents of this entire planet, is struggling with what in this perspective looks like a very small proportion of the amount of people who are at the moment misplaced. So that's one point. And very, very briefly, a second point. I think in Europe it's always has been, and it still is, struggle between the power of the national governments and the European common somehow policy making. And I feel like it's almost natural for national politicians, because what we actually want in order to have action Europe, we ask national politicians to give up their power. And I think that's something, I think, unseen in the history of humankind, when politicians or people in power are actually voluntarily giving up their power. So I think that's already sort of a miracle. But I think that's the basic struggle of the decision-making in European Union. And basically we need, I think, and that's the opinion, in order for Europe as a whole to make decisions easily, for the national governments to give up more of their powers. Basically.
Well, I mean, following on from that, I mean, it's not just the migrant issue, it's not just Schengen which is bringing this up, but something else has happened which is throwing the idea of an ever closer union into question, isn't it? Does the EU have to start thinking about hard power, geopolitics and security in a different fashion?
I mean, if we remember the 1990s and the wars in the Balkans, there was the Western European Union, which was meant to be the military wing of the EU. Nobody likes competition, including NATO. Basically, that idea was killed off, and the Western European Union never sort of picked up. There were police forces in Mostar, in Bosnia, etc., etc. The EU, I think, does need political, a sort of strong arm as well to go along with the soft power, to go along with its economic might. However, there is this conflict of interest. You know, what happens then with NATO? Can Europe be loyal at the same time to its own military branch, and can it be loyal to NATO? So there is this conflict of interest which has so far stopped the EU from having the hard power that you're talking about.
And on this side of the table as well, not only the conflict of interest, but whether or not there would be a will to do something like that. What do you think?
Well, I think what we see is that, I mean, the cause of the refugee influx into the European Union is predominantly the Syrian war. And the inability to resolve it for 4 years is the root cause. So I think it highlights the need that Europe cannot really become an effective global power just through soft power. It needs to be able to engage in the conflicts, at least in its neighborhood, whether it's the Ukraine, whether it's Syria. And I think that's going to be a strong push. Again, I don't expect it to change overnight, but I think it sends the very clear signal that soft power alone cannot confront dictators who are willing to kill their own population. And I think single EU countries can't achieve it as well. So I think it's quite clear that there needs to be a step in that direction. And I don't think this is necessarily a competition to NATO. These can coexist with NATO. But I think that's where the direction has to go into in terms of thinking.
Mm-hmm. Stefano Grueso?
Well, I'm not so sure that Europe will need more like military presence. I think that if Europe will act like together, they will be able to stop almost every war in this world. The problem are the different interests with the countries. You know, Germany is very near from Ukraine. They become gas from Russia. So everyone has an issue, and it's very difficult to act together and to act strong. But I know to put again a new military body in the world, I don't see it.
So to wait, Tim, we're going back to the issue of the decision-making process. As long as we have internal divisions on whether it's the Ukraine or Syria or whatever within the EU, whether we have hard power, whether the EU has hard power or not, doesn't really matter. It's a question of the decision-making process, and it's a question, you know, does the EU have one telephone number from which, you know, you can also make calls and not just receive calls?
But it sounds like what you're coming up with, what you're groping towards, is the idea that not everyone is going to be equal in Europe. And in the 28 member states, some people are more going to be more equal than others.
Isn't that what life is all about? Isn't that the way that we live our everyday lives in wherever we work, wherever we live? No, we're not all equal. And there will be, that's why I'm advocating the asymmetrical union, where those who want to sort of join forces and come to one kind of an decision-making process can get there, and those who don't can stay, and they can be the outer circle. I do not think that we can get everybody to agree upon that, but I'm pretty confident that out of the current 28, at least half would be interested in a federalist Europe with one voice.
I wanted to add something. That only the security question is not all about guns and military. I find it extremely interesting the reasons the Baltic states gave for joining the Eurozone. They joined the Eurozone at the peak of the Eurozone crisis, which looks like it doesn't make any sense. Yet it makes sense for them. They joined, they say, we want to be as much integrated as in Europe as we can, because we see it as a security guarantee against Russia. So I just want to stress that the security issue, it's not only about military budgets and the guns, so to speak, but it's all about the other issues. And I think one important issue as well is that Russia plays a role in the migrant crisis as well, even though it doesn't make sense. But in the Czech Republic, a group of IT experts analyzed the sources of a certain information which was very negative about the immigrants, claiming they're terrorists, they plan to do all sorts of things in Europe, and they trace it to the Russian propaganda websites. In other words, Russia would like to see European Union to dissolve, to be as divided as possible, and don't want Europe to be united. So I think everything connects to everything, and we can't separate the topic.
I wouldn't go into the conspiracy theories, because then you can look at the other side of the mirror and you can say that the United States doesn't want a united Europe or whatever. I'd leave the conspiracy theories aside. I don't believe in them.
So we have to move on. The results are ready from the previous question that we posed to the audience. Here we are. Did the talk, just the mere talk of the possibility of Greece exiting the Eurozone or the EU, weaken the euro? We've got 53.5% said yes and 46.5% said no. I'd like to call on Leah Soyer. How did you answer? Yes.
I personally answered no, because I believe that the union was weak actually before the crisis. And this Greek crisis is just a result of this weakness. And I believe that now that we can point a problem, we can gather together, like people gather together. And I'm not talking about only institutions, but also people from the European Union don't want it to disappear. And yes, that's what I believe.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Leah.
Okay, well, students and alumni, get ready again. I've got another question for you. Does the temporary revoking of free movement across borders, Schengen, permanently hurt the strength of EU values?
So let's let them take time to answer that. We have another video for you. This time touches upon the countries that are in the midst of the process of trying to enter the EU. It's arguable that one of the fundamental principles of the EU is inclusion, and this enlargement process has been going on for years, of course. So let's take a look at what we have.
European Commission President Jean-Claude Juncker has said no new countries will be allowed to join the EU during his five-year mandate. He said that a decision had been taken to consolidate recent progress. Since 2004, 13 countries have joined the Union, including most recently Croatia in 2013. Though ongoing negotiations will continue, the announcement was greeted with alarm in several countries with candidate status, in particular Montenegro, Serbia and Albania, which benefit from a promise of membership made more than a decade ago.
Why would Mr. Juncker come out and say there would be no enlargement for the next 5 years? Let's ask our guests and our audience first about this sensitive issue. Was his message a serious discouragement to the countries that want to join the EU, primarily the Western Balkan countries, but Turkey, of course, as well? Yes or no? He wants to pick that up.
He was stating the obvious. It was pretty obvious that since the negotiations did not begin with any other candidate country apart from Montenegro, that the process would not be finished and nobody would sort of enter during the mandate of this particular commission. However, the way that he said it is certainly very, very discouraging, and I don't think it needed to be said. You know, sometimes you don't necessarily need to state the obvious. I think that what the candidate countries need is actually more encouragement, because that is what helps them in the process. It is the process which makes these countries better. It's not the actual accession as and when it happens, but it is the process. And to keep that process alive, you need messages of encouragement. What came from Mr. Juncker's was definitely a message of discouragement.
Florian?
Well, yeah, I would agree that it was certainly discouragement, but I think it was based on the very clear recognition that most EU citizens are very skeptical about enlargement. In Austria, in Germany, there's a strong majority, and in other countries as well, against enlargement. And I think not just in Turkey, of course, that's always the least popular country to join, but also the Western Balkans. So I think we have to be aware that the EU has to confront its citizens who are against enlargement. Of course, this is a product of the economic crisis, of previous enlargements, which many citizens see as having been premature, although I would disagree with that. But I think the problem is that the message of Jean-Claude Juncker was not to say we need to convince our own citizens why enlargement is in our interest, but rather kind of play on that theme. And of course, the message was discouraging, although, of course, it does take 6-7 years to join the European Union, even in the best case scenario for a country like Montenegro. So if the countries move on, they will join, but not as soon as maybe some politicians domestically like to say in the region.
If I can pick up on what you said, yes, he was playing to the home audience within the EU, and he was addressing the fears of the EU voters. But a politician can sort of follow the voter sentiment, or he can try to push his own agenda and to persuade the voters otherwise. Or you disagree?
No, I mean, I'm going to say something quite hard, but who the hell is this Mr. Juncker? I mean, how can he allow to say something like that? I mean, we are Europe, these countries are Europe, and they have the right to enter. And that's very clear. This Juncker is going to be in his office for a couple of years, but he cannot ask what he wants. I mean, there are some fundamental rules that we have
to comply. Well, he's the chairman of the European Commission,
yes,
so
I know.
It's kind
know,
of
but
a
he will go.
Position to be...
And there are some... That's what I come always to the same point. I mean, we have to rethink Europe. What is Europe? It's a kind of supermarket in order to sell goods and to buy goods, or it is something else, something very complex and something where we have to allow other Europeans to come in. That's the thing.
Stefan, I mean, picking up on that, of course, Nenad was right, so no country would be ready to join within the next 5 years. But let's imagine that somebody is ready to join in, let's say, for the sake of argument, 10 years. What sort of EU do you envisage in 10 years' time? What sort of place is it going to be? You keep mentioning this idea of rethinking Europe. Well, what do you think is the Europe that's coming? What would you like, or what do you think will be there?
Well, you see, I'm kind of very European. I was born in Spain, I'm French, I live like 10 years in Germany. But I want a real Europe, not only this kind of supermarket, I talk about it. You know, we need this fiscal union, and then we need a common policy in some issues that we don't have. So we have to work in this. It's going to be very difficult. It is, in every single small parliament, it's very difficult, and in Europe it's going to be, but we have to create these mechanisms to act, to do things, to bring democracy. You have here a lot of words in your set, and I can read democracy. It's just democracy. It's this. I mean, we have to fight for this democracy. And we're all together in Europe, and we have to push this.
So you wouldn't go with the idea of this Europe a la carte, where you can pick and choose. It should be one union?
I'm not sure of the model, to tell the truth. I don't know if it has to be this kind of different speech Europe or not, but it has to be a true Europe, not only this kind of neoliberal place to move money that Europe is now. I mean, we have to go on.
I think there's one thing where there should be no picking and choosing. Since I was advocating the multi-tier Europe, obviously a kind of pick and choose, but there's one thing where I don't think there should be a compromise. The EU, for me, was always a project about values. It's also the greatest peacemaking project in the history of the human race, but primarily it's a system of values. I see these values being shattered and literally disappearing, definitely being under great threat for several years now. And I think that we need to reinforce, when rethinking Europe, when thinking what do we want to be like tomorrow and in 10 years from now, I think we need to go back to those values. I think we need to establish them. We need to literally make a list. And that is not a pick and choose list. That is a must-do list.
We have. We can go to the answer, the audience results from our previous question now. Does the temporary revoking of free movement across the borders permanently hurt the strength of EU values? See what we had. Yes, 27.9%, and no, 72.1%. So that's quite resounding.
Well, I'm going to ask you, Tamara Petkovska, would you like to comment on your answers and the results?
Yes, I've also voted no, because I believe that the last informal meeting of the EU heads of the state will overcome this crisis, and I think that they will maintain the EU values, and also I think that they will try to agree for the key issues to resolve this problem.
And the final question for our audience, does a temporary hold on EU enlargement discourage the countries that want to join the EU? That's a yes or no. You have the country there, and they can get going on that one.
Well, we've talked about enlargement, but let's come back to something that we talked about at the beginning, which is the threat of Britain leaving. As I said, the British government wants to negotiate a new deal, but which will then be put to a referendum. Europe's in a state of flux. I do want to insist on this. I've asked you, Stefan, but I'm going to ask everybody else now. It's like, what's this continent going to look like in 5 or 10 years' time?
Do you have some more difficult question for us?
Is that the easiest to control?
Well, I'm just asking you to take out your crystal balls. We all asked you to bring crystal balls to the studios, but I can't see them on this. But what's in your crystal ball, do you think?
I'm an eternal optimist. And that comes from the fact that I am very much interested in history. And I think anybody who is interested in history must see that the progress, however difficult, however with challenges, however with crises, it's going away from a very tedious 20th century towards something better. I mean, you mentioned it on the beginning. Let's not forget 70 years ago, which is a lifetime of a person, this continent was in ruins. And I mean physical ruins, but also ruins of values and of the high civilization we were so proud of having. And only 25 years ago, the continent was separated by a wall and in a constant brink of a war, which had possibility, by the way, to destroy the entire planet. So I feel like we still, despite all the problems, live in a fantastic time. And I'm very much optimistic about what's going to happen. So I'm going to take a leap of faith. We'll see in 10 years. Well, I'll play back this speech. And I think it will resolve one way or another. But I don't think the European Union will stop existing in its current form.
Great. Also, I'd like to just throw out the possibility that there will be more countries, not just enlargement classic, as perhaps I might term it. But the issue of Scottish independence is still very much on the agenda, despite the referendum last year. And, of course, now the possibility of Catalan independence, the breakup of Spain as well as the United Kingdom. Does that matter within the terms of Europe as a whole, or is it just a kind of natural development and within the kind of European home of the EU? Is that OK or not?
Right. Let's first hear from Stefan Egruy, so maybe we could have an update and then see what that might mean for Europe as a whole.
Well, the thing is that in regions and as well in Europe, in some countries, there are new political forces that are coming. So we are going to have this year some much more dynamic politics. It's going to be much more complicated, but things are going to happen. So I'm looking forward to it. Now in Catalonia, we have this complication that they want to leave Spain. And if they leave, maybe they will leave the EU as well. In Scotland, they will come again. But I don't know. But I will say that with this process where these new parties are coming in, there are some problems like the extreme right coming and so on. But we will have a Europe that will be a little bit more like the people will. But, you know, we have these big parties in Spain. We have the Socialist Party, the Popular Party, which are more or less the same the last 50 years. But now things are happening, so it's going to be very dynamic. And in Spain now we are observing Catalonia. We don't know what's going to happen. And maybe it's difficult for us. Spain without Catalonia would be just another country. But I don't have the solution. I'm just looking forward and let's see what happens.
Florian Bieber, I wanted to ask you as well. What about that? What if one of the member states breaks up? Does Europe care? Is there a...
Well, of course Europe cares. And of course it hasn't found the answer also how to respond to it. We saw it with the Scottish referendum where the whole discussion was, can Scotland remain in the European Union? Because, of course, this was one of the main pillars of the advocates of independence, that they wanted to remain in the EU. And in fact, if the referendum would have happened closer to the British referendum on leaving the European Union, it would have been an interesting dynamic because there's been a much stronger majority in Scotland in favour of the European Union than in the rest of the United Kingdom. So I mean, the European Union hasn't found an answer. How can you remain within the European Union if you decide to secede from the country? Because formally, all the criteria are fulfilled. But, I mean, we had statements back when the referendum was in Scotland that Spain would, in fact, be the strongest advocate of keeping Scotland out of the European Union, of course, for rather selfish reasons. But I think we need to find an answer to that. You know, what kind of... Is the European Union just a union of nation states or something else of all of its citizens and also the units of the nation states, so that if one decides to leave, you know, and it's a question not just for Catalonia and Scotland. Belgium is the eternal question, of course. Will it survive? It survived mostly because of the European Union. But, you know, will it continue to exist for the next 20, 30 years? Maybe, maybe not. And it's also a question for countries which are seeking to join, like Bosnia-Herzegovina, which is a very weak state, which, you know, has very minimal competences. But once it's in the European Union, the question will look quite different because, again, lots of decisions are taken in Brussels or in the EU level rather than the nation state level. So it actually makes, on one side, disintegration easier. But on the other side, it doesn't happen. I mean, no country which has joined the European Union has had a part of its territory effectively secede. So in that sense, it's also mediated. I mean, Northern Ireland is the place which one always points to, saying that if you cross the border from Ireland to Northern Ireland, you don't notice that you're going from one part to the other, from one country to the other. And that's, of course, the result of the European Union to a large degree.
Mm-hmm. So we're back to the crystal ball on this side.
Well, I've already had one country disintegrate on me. I was born in the former Yugoslavia, and that dissolution was one which was immersed in blood. I would really hate to see my other country, the United Kingdom, do the same. It would not go through a war, of course. What happened in the former Yugoslavia would not happen either in the UK or Spain or Belgium, indeed. But I would not like it to happen because I believe that, you know, the EU is more than the sum of its parts. I believe that the United Kingdom is more than the sum of its parts. And if I see the United Kingdom falling apart into Scotland and Wales might be next, Northern Ireland might be next, etc., etc., I think that the overall result will be a loss to everybody. I do not think that there are gains in the fragmentation of this kind. As for the crystal ball and looking ahead 10, 20 years from now, you said you were an eternal optimist. I've been described as a pathological optimist. So I do see a two-tier Europe, possibly even a three-tier Europe. I do see, I'm a very, very convinced pro-federalist, so I see a federalist core, which will probably consist of the old EU, Germany, France, the Benelux countries, Austria, with most of the countries which have recently gained sovereignty after the dissolution of the Soviet Union probably opting to be in the outer circle because they're hungry for sovereignty. But I see this two-tier Europe functioning actually pretty well and having a strong and positive influence on the global stage.
I think it's time to go to the results of our final question. Here we are. Does a temporary hold on EU enlargement discourage the countries that want to join the EU? Yes, 54.3%, and no, 45.7%. And I'd like to turn to Tamara Brunkovic to discuss your answer, please.
Okay, well, I was kind of pessimistic this time. I voted yes, so I belong to this majority. And why is that so? It's because I think that without strong EU pressure, combined actions and statements, the space for conducting painful but necessary reforms shrinks. And elites are not actually willing to conduct those reforms on their own. So I'm afraid that the sensitivity of the Western Balkans to authoritarian regimes will become even more visible in the time to come, and that will drag the region away from the EU. And I think that is the situation in which everyone loses.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Tamara. Thank you.
Florian, I know that you've been writing about the emergence of authoritarian regimes. Is Tamara kind of justified in her fears of the future of authoritarian regimes? Not necessarily in the whole of Europe, obviously, but certainly in amongst the Western Balkan states and applicant states for the EU?
Well, I think, yeah, the further away EU accession seems, the greater is the temptation to bend the rules, the democratic rules. And I think we see in quite a number of countries of the Western Balkans, they've become more authoritarian in recent years. Media freedoms have been reversed in many cases. There's been a clampdown on civil society in a number of cases. So I would say that there's definitely a significant step back. And if we include Turkey in that equation, I mean, Turkey has moved towards kind of strong kind of authoritarianism quite significantly in recent years. So I'd say that that's a real worry, and even in the European Union itself. I mean, we haven't talked about the Viktor Orban phenomena, but Hungary, which has really radically become a more authoritarian state in the last 5 years, essentially. And, you know, now it became more public debate in Europe because of the policy towards the refugees. But I think this is, you know, the reflection of an authoritarian politician who acts within a democracy, but who has been systematically dismantling liberal democratic institutions. And I think if you can get away with that in the European Union, this, of course, sends a signal to countries which are not even in yet that they can maybe go the same direction.
Would the optimists like to pick up on that?
Well, I completely agree, so it's not a very interesting answer. But coming from the so-called new country, even though it's absurd to call it new after 11 years, but come from the 10 which joined during the 2004 enlargement, I can see a profound effect the negotiations had on so many levels of Czech society, on judiciary system, probably didn't say it correctly in English, sorry about that, on so many levels of the society and of politics. So I think it's crucial to maintain that negotiation process. So exactly, I agree with you both. I think it's very healthy, and also it's the part I don't understand on Juncker's announcement was that he must know, I know it's for the viewers, but he must know it's also selfish. Europe has selfish reasons for this, because it's always better to be surrounded by more friendly states and states which adopted certain reforms rather than authoritarian regimes like we discuss it. So it's important to maintain at least the negotiation process, which is happening anyway. So I'm not worried in this sense. I mean,
Stephanie Grace, I see you nodding in agreement.
Yes, I mean, in this Europe that I imagine, there will be some kind of control over the people in the EU. It seems to me that once you enter, you can do what you want. In Spain, we recently passed the so-called GOC law, which affects a lot of fundamental civil liberties. I'm sure that our constitutional tribunal will take it down, but it will take like 10 years. But no one in Europe says anything. You know, we have now some of our civil rights compromised, and Europe is not there. So, I mean, we need some kind of, I don't know, institution, tribunal, some vigilance thing in order to oblige the people in the European Union to comply to these basics. They're only basics. And that doesn't happen. So I hope to see some development in this direction.
And then that?
I would think that one always needs to be aware of the dangers of authoritarian rule, and not just in the Western Balkans, where I agree with everything that Florian said. And it's not just Hungary. I think that basically we need to keep our eyes wide open for any sort of initial signs of authoritarianism. And they have been showing throughout Europe, they have not taken actual power anywhere else apart from Hungary at the moment, but the signs are there, and I think we need to be aware of those signs, and I think that EU as such needs to react in some kind of a way, and it needs to permanently be vigilant when it comes to the basic freedoms and the basic values of the EU.
Could just jump in here.
Go ahead, yes, please.
I mean, I think what we're going to see also as a result of the refugee influx is we're going to see a rise of populist parties. I mean, we saw it in Austria recently, elections in Upper Austria, where the Freedom Party won a third of the vote, right? And they might become even stronger in other elections, and similarly in France, elsewhere. And I think if the EU has no mechanism to deal with a party like that coming to power, we have to be, you know, with all optimism, with due respect, we also have to anticipate what to do if a populist, anti-immigrant, nationalist party comes to power and how the EU responds to that. It botched it in 1999 when the Freedom Party in Austria came to government. It was kind of a half-hearted sanctions for a few months, and that was the end of the story. But what if it happens again? And I think the EU has not found an answer, and I think that's why the EU needs to come in and says, these are the red lines. If you cross them, then there are consequences.
I mean, I think you bring up a really good point there, is it has to find an answer. What is the answer? At what level?
Well, there has to be a clear mechanism of penalties if you cross these red lines. I mean, the thing is now there's only the nuclear option, as they always call it, where, you know, suspending voting rights and so on.
Exactly.
But I think nobody wants to go there because it is really quite a radical. But there have to be interim steps, stopping funding, for example, some kind of other, temporary suspending voting rights or other mechanisms, excluding from symbolic opportunities. The fact that Orban can always show up and shake hands with the highest politician in Europe, you know, kind of makes it very hard for anybody trying to criticize his authoritarian practices, because he can say, well, I'm friends with Juncker, I'm friends with EU politicians, so how can you accuse me of not being a Democrat? And this kind of making them a bit more of an outcast, ostracizing them, I think, is going to be quite important as a signal.
And can you regulate that? Can you set norms, stages?
What are the red lines, in other words? Right. I don't know, maybe the EU needs some kind of an outside body, an independent think tank, which would sort of be the devil's advocate. Maybe I think we need a sort of very strong devil's advocate to look at all possible scenarios and come up with suggestions which the EU then, through its mechanisms, can look at and agree upon. But I think that the red lines that Florian is talking about are very important. But what are they? We don't know where they are, and we have no suggestions as to where they should be.
And again, if you ask different governments, if you have different oppositions
answers.
In different national states, you have very different answers.
Yes.
So again, we come to the, I think, the ultimate problem of European Union, which is that it's very, the variety of voices and the variety of opinions, it is and it's always going to be wide. And that makes it so hard to come to a conclusion. But I think one thing that's I thought recently, how usually national politicians criticize European Union for lack of democratic principles. And I think what's really interesting to see that with the quotas discussion, it was decided by majority of voices, quite clear majority. And yet the same politicians who said European Union doesn't function on democratic principles were also criticizing it. So then you would have to account what the politicians actually say. Because if I don't know what else is more democratic principle than the majority decides. So it's all very complex and all very unclear. So I think that's, yeah. Part of the problem.
Well, luckily, you're an optimist.
So. That's right. Call for everyone to have your final comment about what we talked about today. Let's start with you, Stephanie Grueso.
Well, I think we need a real Europe. You know, in 2011, we went to the squares in Spain, the so-called 15M movement, the Indignados, and we called for a real democracy. We have democracy, but it's not real. So now I think we need this real Europe, not this Europe of intention, not this Europe of science, not this Europe of bureaucrats, but a real Europe that decides, that acts united, that respects the human rights, and that goes to the future.
Okay. Florian Bieber.
Well, I think we need to get out of the crisis mode. I mean, Europe has been in a crisis mode for years and now needs to get in a future mode, in a mode of kind of thinking about what the crisis means for Europe. And that means strategically thinking about what the European Union should look like in 10 years. And ironically, I mean, the European Convention, which dealt and which kind of drafted the European Constitution, was maybe 10 years early. It should have been now. It should be actually now when you have this debate, and of course much more open than the European Convention was at the time, to really discuss maybe not a constitution, but, you know, constitution not in the written text, but what constitutes Europe? What, you know, what kind of Europe we want, and get out of, let's solve this problem, this problem, this problem, and then at the end of the day, we don't even know where we're at. So I think we need to think more strategically, and I think the time is now for this debate.
I couldn't agree more with Florian. I mean, in a way, a number of EU officials are behaving like local politicians. In other words, they care about the next elections, or rather they care about the mandate of their own commission. They do not care about the next generation. I think we need people in the EU structures who are thinking about the next generation, who are thinking strategically ahead. I also believe that the constitution issue should be brought back onto the agenda, and that I think that we should have maybe, as I said, either a think tank or a body established by the European Commission, which will look into what is the long-term future of the EU and how do we get there, and should not worry about whether this move is going to be popular or not popular with voters in this or that country, or how is it going to affect the referendum in the UK or the elections in Catalonia.
Sylvie Lauder?
I couldn't agree more. Optimistic doesn't mean not being realistic, so I am fully aware that it's going to be a difficult and long process. And what you said, all three, it's of course we wish that would be the case, that should be a long-term vision. However, in this case, I'm slightly less optimistic. I feel like it'll be a long-term process to actually find this common ground. And I feel it's more likely that these individual crises will change the Europe rather than the long-term general strategy of the continent.
Thank you very much for that last word. And I'd like to thank you all, guests and audience, for being with us here on this edition of the show, Quo Vadis Europe.
Thank you for joining us for Vicinities Europe. It's been a very interesting hour, and we hope to see you back here again soon.